Hello, you're tuned into WFMU. Oh my gosh, we have John Waters and Mink Stole live in the studio, and the studio is Moose Lodge here at Camp John Waters. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you for having me.
Have you ever done the radio show live from here before?
No, this is first time broadcaster, longtime listener.
Yeah, great. We got a great crowd. It's one of the biggest crowd we've ever had, I think. Most
They're
people
wonderful.
Had a huge waiting list to get in. It's exciting.
Camp John Waters is like the greatest experience ever. For those who don't know, yearly Valhalla for us crazies.
Well, it's people I've seen come dressed as a lamp in one of my movies. You know, that's pretty amazing. Yeah. Talk about an obscure crowd. But the crowd here is great. We call it Jonestown with a happy ending. But, you know, Jonestown, now, it's true. I know some survivors, and I read their newsletter. And they all say that it was murder because none of them would have killed themselves without him being there with the armed guards and everything. So it is the rethinking of what happened with Jonestown. It was actually a mass murder rather than a suicide. And that might be a way to put a spin on it, but in a way it is true. So Jonestown, I make fun of it, but I have been on Memorial Day to the mass grave in Oakland where all the unclaimed bodies are. And it is very, very sad.
Oh, no. That I feel like coming to camp, comparing it to Jonestown is...
I say Jonestown with a happy ending.
Yeah. Okay. Nobody here has to die.
No, and everybody has a mind of their own.
Yes.
And there's good cults like Gays Against Guns and Radical Fairies, and there's bad ones like the Catholic Church. And,
yes.
Know, and, well, never mind.
So you guys just finished telling scary stories to the campers?
Well, no, it wasn't scary stories.
It wasn't scary stories like campfire stories. It was stories about when we were scared.
What scared us when we were young. We did scary stories another year, didn't we?
We did that last year.
We did a sexy story. What else?
I don't remember a sexy story. I did scary story last year. You might have done
sexy. I think you did a sexy story. I talked about Brad Renfrew when he was dead.
Oh, yes.
And I forget what yours were.
I forget. I forget about sexy.
I was going to ask we have a lot of questions from the listeners, but I wanted to ask my question first because it's my show. You both have been friends for so long, like since 1966.
56 years.
That's amazing. What do you think has kept you so close? People change a lot over time. What do you think has kept you together along these years?
Well, friendship is work. You know, Facebook is not being friends. You have to get dressed. You have to go out. You have to call people. It takes effort to have old friends, but I don't trust people that don't.
We get together, you know, a couple times a year to have dinner. We see each other. We talk.
Yeah. And we stay in touch, which requires an effort.
Yeah.
And Facebook, you don't have to get your hair done. You don't have to brush your teeth. You don't have to do it. That's not social. That's like cheating.
And we can drink together.
Yes.
So, and you know, and we work together too.
Yeah.
You know, we have done lots of work together. You know, we did the Calvin Klein commercial this year together.
That was
like,
so...
who would have ever thought, you know, that would happen?
I love being a fashion model at my age and my size.
Free underpants.
Yes.
Tell me everything about that experience.
They sent me some free stuff this
week. They did.
Yeah.
Oh,
I got new stuff.
New
this
stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, I haven't gotten new stuff. I got some a few weeks ago.
Oh, that's what I mean. Like a few weeks ago. Yeah. What did you
get? She wants today.
Sweatpants. Really nice.
Good
ones.
I got a black denim jacket and some pants. Yes, it was lovely.
And I got a jean jacket that doesn't fit, so I gave it to a friend of mine.
I gave some of mine away that didn't fit either, but still.
Stuff.
I think it's great. It's great. I've done three campaigns. I did Yves Saint Laurent and Nike.
That's amazing. And also the cover of Town and Country recently.
Yeah, don't ever get a facelift. It gets me jobs, wrinkles. My mustache gets me the jobs. It gets me all the jobs.
Oh, I painted on a mustache for somebody tonight.
Did you?
Yeah.
Did you?
As a matter of fact, maybe next year we'll have a booth.
Yeah.
And I'll paint mustaches on people.
I love it. We're brainstorming already.
Now most of the women I know have mustaches anyway. But also, I think all women must have, because why is there so many in the Rite Aid, so many hair removal places? I think all women have beards.
It's
not the trans movement. They just do.
They don't
put Nair on. Because why is there so many products? I didn't know that all women basically have to shave,
I know
too.
Women who shave.
You do?
I don't shave, but I don't even have hair under my arms. I've got no hair.
What?
But it's,
that's sharing.
I know.
Thank you.
Well, they say also later, that when you're older, when women get hair on their face, it means they're going to die. I've heard that before. Like when I don't know if that's true.
I hope not, because I do have one chin hair that comes back repeatedly.
Well, that's why they have Nair. Do they still even have Nair?
It's pluckable.
Nair, I always just remember growing up, there was always like, that's when I'm so...
No, Nair was for legs, generally.
Oh, it was for legs?
But they do have it. They have facial Nair and they have bikini wax Nair.
Wait, there's separate Nair?
What's that?
There's separate Nair for different...
They have
Nair. So I need several Nairs.
They have Nair for bottom?
Shelves full. Oh, yes, there are definitely Nairs for bottoms. It's called Sensitive.
Well, they have all the new products. I heard an ad on the radio the other day for a new one, Rectacare. Oh, what a hideous name for a brand. I guess it's some kind of anal medicine. I don't know for what, but they said, get Rectacare. I thought, Rectacare?
Why?
I want a jacket that says that.
I love the ads for medication where they're like, if you're severely allergic to this medication, don't take it. Like, yeah.
My favorite ever helpful. Ad I heard was, what is it? Like, my number one problem is number two. However, I want number three, this new medicine. And it was called like that. And I thought that was a brilliant ad. I had never heard of number three. That's when you have both, I guess. I don't know. My number one problem is number two.
Number two.
A good ad. The other great when I was growing up, the garbage company in Baltimore said on the side, we never refuse refuse. So it was a literary campaign.
I love a double intender. No, just kidding. Should we get to fan questions? I feel like they've been waiting, and it's my job. So
work, girl.
Work. First up, we have from Siggy on the message board had asked. Siggy, like.
Siggy.
Siggy. Said, I read that Mr. Waters is getting a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. Does he have a preference as to what two stars he'd like to be sandwiched in between? Follow-up question, same for Mink.
Well, you don't get a choice. You don't get to pick where it is. And I don't care. In a way, I hope it's in the worst location. So the lowest people can walk over me and think, God, I wish I was in porn or some other worse, horrible Hollywood experience and puddles catch in it. And someone said, oh, near the gutter. But if I was going to be between anybody, I would be the furthest away from Trump's because they deface his all the time. I would be between Alvin the Chipmunk and maybe... all my choices. I wait till they put Divine in.
Aw.
I don't expect one.
Why not?
I just don't. I mean,
You deserve one?
Well, sure. Everybody deserves a star somewhere.
No, wait. Yeah, but the very first time I ever went to Los Angeles, I drove across the country with David Lockery and another friend that we put in a mental institution on the way. And we got out at Hollywood and Vine, literally. I walked across the street, got a jaywalking ticket. For the first time, and then walked down Hollywood Boulevard. So that is the very first thing I ever did in Hollywood. So to get a star there, to me, is huge. It's hilarious. I'm going to bring a picture of my parents and put it down there when I do it, because they would be so proud.
They'd
and, you
be
know,
thrilled, yeah.
And just to, you know, show, you know, things change. You know, if you stick around long enough, people accept things and celebrate you. God knows, you know, there are people here that weren't born when I made my last movie, much less Pink Flamingo. So it's really great to see the people here, how young they are and how enthusiastic they are. And it's just really incredibly loving and, you know, it's a great thing to see.
I feel like, especially at camp, it's such a loving environment. So I thank you as well.
It's amazing to me. I mean, I look around and I see all these people and I think, my God, something I was a part of created this. Helped to create this.
I know. And Kathleen Turner was here and she said, my God, darling, this is unbelievable. And Ricky Lake said the same thing. No matter what, when you come in, you see it, yikes. But that's why I never let a documentary. They all want to make documentaries about it. I always say no, because then the outside world will know what it is. This is a secret here. This is our private thing. There's no guest list. There's no press here ever. We don't do that because then the people will know what happens here. Then it isn't special.
Exactly. I feel like it's such an honor to be able to broadcast from here in our little secret moose cave.
Have you been talking to campers?
No.
Are you going to?
Well, yes.
No.
I mean, I don't do that. No. I'm a camper myself, so I couldn't take the night off. So they kindly allowed me to broadcast live and said that you would stop by at the end. So what a treat.
Give us more questions.
Yeah, you have them.
Yeah. More questions.
Yeah. All right, let's do this. Ruby asks, what current artists are you listening to?
I mean music.
Correct.
I don't listen to anybody current. And it's not because I don't like them. It's just I don't know who they are. And I find contemporary music just absolutely baffling. So, but I have lots of favorites. I mean, I still listen to Dinah Washington a lot. I still listen to Nina Simone. I still listen to, there is a woman, Catherine Russell, that I absolutely love. And I don't think she's even particularly famous, but she's got a great voice and I love listening to her. So, every now and then a Justin Bieber tune will earworm me.
I like Justin too. I listen to the Baltimore Gang. I listen to Beach House. I listen to Future Islands. I listen to, also I like Astrid Olsen. I like her. I like King Cruel. I like.
Shocking.
Yeah. I like, who's the one, Princess something. She's new. I like her a lot. She's kind of butch and Princess something. I like her. So I do listen to new music and I get billboards. So I know what everybody is. That's why the only way I'd know. And I have youth spies that tell me new ones that are good. And I read record reviews and I still buy CDs. I'm really old fashioned because then I put them in my Sonos system, but I like to hold it. I don't want just a streaming thing. There's no marketing. I can't save the album. I'd like to have the hard copy. So I do still listen to new music and like it, but I get recommendations or read reviews.
Well, speaking of music, I feel like your soundtracking work has been so incredible. You found so many like deep cuts. How were you picking the music for that?
Well, the same way. I mean, music to me is the narrator. If you ever see a movie and there's a narrator, you meant that they had a test screening and people didn't understand the plot, so you put in a narrator. But music tells the story too. I use it to tell the story. Lyrics that tell the story. And to me, I've had every kind of music. I had the Locusts in my movie. I had classical music. I had punk rock. I had all different kinds. I've had everybody from Liberace to the Chipmunks. And I just think that I use it to tell a story, like Flying Saucer, the first novelty record I ever heard that told a story by sampling, the first sampling they ever did, and they had to pay. They lost in court. By sampling lyrics from other things to tell a story. That's what I've done. And I it's another character in my movies. But I love to use music in movies. When I write a movie and turn it in, I turn in the soundtrack with not the score, that's different, but the music that plays through it as just so you're reading it. It's in the initial script what music is going to play because it's such a part of it. It's like a character in my movies completely.
I feel like even in your books, like with Karsik.
Oh, I had in Karsik. Yeah. I had a song for everything. And the only thing in Liar Mouth, she hates music because it competes with her. She doesn't like anything.
I want to come back to Liar Mouth, but we have a fan question for Mink about your music as well. They really appreciated Do Re Mink.
Oh, thank you. I have to admit, I don't think I've ever been happier than when I was making that album.
It's a great album.
I loved being in the studio. I loved working with my musicians. I had the musicians laid out all of the instrumental tracks for me, and then I would go home, and I would get so stoned on marijuana, and I would play it over and over again and just experiment with the vocal arrangements. And I had the best time, and then I'd come back in the studio. And I love being in the studio because in the studio, you can make it right. You can do it again and again and again until you absolutely have it right. I never used auto-tune. Every note that was sung on that album, I sang myself. And I absolutely loved it. So thank you to this particular fan. And I'm very, very proud of it.
When I heard it for the first time, I said to Mink, why didn't you tell me you could sing? Because it's like Julie London. It's not what people expect if it's going to be punk or like something. But she's an amazing voice, you know. I play the album still.
Thank you.
Will you do another album?
I don't know. That one nearly killed me, but I might.
You should.
It could happen.
Definitely should.
It could happen.
You know, with Liar Mouth, I was going to say, I don't know if it's projection or maybe overthinking it, but I feel like there are hints of divine still in it. Like, I feel like in Polyester, She calls Lulu a liar mouth with a report card.
That's right. She did. I know. I forgot that.
And then the trampoline for some reason reminds me of female. Yeah.
You know, when I'm writing it, to be honest, I didn't think of Divine, but I'm saying that the character is certainly would have gotten along with Dawn Davenport, would have gotten along with Beverly Sutphin, would have gotten along with Babs Johnson, would have gotten along. All those women could have had a book club.
Okay, we'll go to more fan questions and then I'll go back to mine. I feel very selfish right now. Dan F.A. has asked, have you ever considered adapting Fruitcake as an audio play now that podcasts are so huge?
Well, Fruitcake, I am still trying to do a movie, so we'll see. So no.
Is it going to happen?
I can't talk about it. Maybe.
And surely you must be in it. You've been in every feature since the beginning.
I answer to nothing about this. No. I cannot.
It's in my contract. I'm not allowed to talk about it. So movie are you talking about?
I can't speculate for John.
This is very exciting. No breaking news happening.
No, it's no breaking news.
No. Okay, we have another question for Mink. How many marriages have you performed? And are there any that stand out?
I haven't done any for a while. I actually, the very first time I did one, I was doing a Kickstarter for my album. You know, I produced the album myself, so I needed to raise the money. And one of the prizes, I forget what they call it, the prizes or the benefits or the premiums, was I said, if give me $1,000, I'll marry you. Not marry you, but I will marry you. And I got a couple. So, that was how it got started. Everybody that gets married, I love people getting married. I think weddings, you hate weddings.
I've done 24 marriages and only two have broken up. Huh? That's not a bad one. I did one last week in Provincetown, Scream Along with Billy, and he asked me to marry him and his boyfriend on stage as a surprise in the middle of the show, and I did.
Very
That's
nice.
Amazing.
I've only done a few, but they've been really fun, and I've enjoyed it. But I don't
do them because they want me to be a photo op at the wedding. So I only will do it if I have known you for a really long time, and it's not a big wedding. I'm not going to show and be a photo op.
Right, you're just not a piece of meat.
Well, I am a piece of meat, but that's by choice.
You're not a photographic piece of meat.
No. I'm not for your cheap wedding album.
So another fan question. We had two fans ask the same question. Do either of you have any Cookie Mueller stories that you can share? I feel like she's having a major renaissance now with the reissue.
She's having
a
great renaissance.
It's really beautiful.
Most amazing review in the LA Times of the re-release of her book, saying she's as good as Eve Babbitt. You know, like amazing, amazing reviews she's getting right now. And she deserves it. I wish Cookie had tried to be a writer from the very beginning rather than an actress. She was a better writer than actress. She's great in my movies, but she had a speech impediment. It's hard to be an actress. But she was a really, really, really good writer. And she's great in the movies, too, I'm saying. But, yes, I'm so happy that that's happening. Well, I wish she was alive to see it. But it's nice for Max, her son, who was the little baby in The Pit and Pink Flamingos, who I see all the time.
Him.
He's in Provincetown. I saw him this year. Yeah.
Wow. Do you have any stories that you could share about
Cookie? My stories
of
Cookie are so long and complicated, I can't really go into them. But it's I miss her.
I'll give you a real quick one. Every night before she used to go out in New York, she didn't have time, so she would snort instant coffee.
She didn't have time.
To make it.
That's
so
amazing.
She would just put a line of instant coffee down and snort it.
That's amazing.
Sure it wasn't brown Coke.
Yeah.
No, she did that later.
I feel like that must have been hard, like the amount of drugs that was around and how many people went too far.
Well, Cookie and I were estranged from that. Cookie liked heroin. I didn't, and we had fights about it. We were estranged for a long period because of that.
I imagine with a lot of the Dreamlanders and the whole scenes, like that must have been wild back then.
But not with drugs. I mean, we took them, but not on the set.
No, when we were making movies, as far as I knew, I don't even, maybe people smoked pot, but they did in front of me. It was too hard. We worked like 12-hour days.
They were long.
I was on pot when I wrote them. Up to Pink Flamingos.
And I'm on pot now as often as possible.
Yes.
I don't ever smoke pot. It makes me nervous now. It makes me worry.
I eat it. I have
favorites. Oh, God, I got dosed. Oh, no, I don't. No. Only drugs gummies. I take are, well, even poppers I haven't taken. And then Mink and I took LSD together, which I wrote about in my book, when we were 70 years old. It was great. We hadn't done it for 50 years. It was stronger than any acid. 40, whatever it was. 19, yes. But it worked. It's the strongest acid.
It was really good.
And I was fully hallucinating, but it was great.
And it was walls like this.
Yeah, and the holes were jumping out. And it was Bear Week. We didn't go out. It was Provincetown. I wasn't going out on Bear Week tripping.
Why did you choose to?
Because I wanted to see what it was like. We did it 50 years ago.
We did it a lot 50 years
ago. Yeah, and I always had good experiences. What would it be like? Same reason I hitchhiked across America by myself, to dare myself to do something. I'm not going to trip again. I did. It was great. You think? Would you trip again? I don't think I would.
Tom wants to. My boyfriend wants to. And I think it would be a terrible idea for us to do it together,
No, I did it again. It was fun, but I don't need to do it again, really. This acid was so good, though. It was amazing.
It was really clean, but I do like my gummies.
I love the gummies. What's your favorite?
I never liked any of the edibles. They always made me paranoid.
Paranoid at all.
What's the other one? Did you ever stuff opium? That's when you put stuff up your ass.
No.
I did once. At a dinner party, somebody said, want to stuff? And I thought, what's that mean? At a dinner party? And everybody went in the bathroom and put some opium up their ass. I did it once.
I'm going to
stuff
probably
the next booster shot.
I would have probably if anybody had offered it to me, but nobody did. Maybe it's a gay thing.
No, this was... Yeah. This was mostly gay. There was one hetero couple there.
Were they stuffing?
And they're still together.
Were they stuffing?
Yeah, they did.
Oh, okay.
I mean, and I didn't see them do it, but I didn't see the gay people do it. Every person went into the privacy of the bathroom to stuff. That's why I can't think of Thanksgiving. I saw my mother fist fucking a turkey. So I can never get over that either.
I'd like to remind you we are live on the radio.
We got to wrap this up soon.
Anytime that you're ready, I'm sorry, I've been one more question. We will, I'm going to finish with Chandler's question that said, what are your hopes for the future of outsider cinema?
I'm not an outsider cinema. I'm not. I knew what I was doing. I read Variety when I was 13. An outsider artist is someone who is mentally challenged that accidentally becomes an artist. I was ruthlessly trying to become one.
I love it. And apparently there's a film, and we heard it here first.
We knew what we were doing. I mean, I didn't know what I was doing technically, but I knew about Variety. I knew what theater to play it in. I knew about the business. An outsider artist, to me, is somebody that is outside the system. Like Pecker, I made a movie. He was basically an outsider artist that didn't know.
I think of outsider artists as art that is created by somebody who is compelled to do it without really knowing how. And doing what, you know, what he has to do.
Well, we had to do that.
Yeah,
too.
I know we did, but
I mean, driven.
But without considering the business aspect.
Or hearing voices to tell them what to do, or that kind of thing.
Without a definite commercial intent.
Well, I feel like you knew the rules very well, and so you broke them intentionally.
I wanted to make a new genre, which was exploitation films for art theaters, and there was no such thing, really. Well, Warhol did. Because my films did not work in real exploitation theaters or drive-ins, because the exploitation audience knew we were making fun of that genre. They work best in the richest, smartest neighborhoods, which is embarrassing to admit.
It let rich, smart people feel hip.
Well, nothing's changed.
Not all rich people are bad. Who else backs movies?
Right?
No poor people I know ever gave me money to make a movie.
I got nothing against most rich people.
I got a lot against most people, but it just depends. I don't, the economics of it depends on their politics and cuteness.
Yeah, that always helps.
Cuteness counts.
I want to thank you again for taking the time to come visit WFMU. I'm so thankful for your energy and time, and camp is amazing. I can't wait to let my hair down now.
Is this your first time?
No, second. Okay. I'm back for more.
Are you entering the costume contest?
I hope so. Maybe.
Right. We'll tomorrow. See.
Yeah, tomorrow.
I'm thinking about it.
I know. I mean, I did bring some things. Okay, yes.
There
I
you
will
go.
Be there.
All right.
Well, you mentioned Andy Warhol, so I'm going to go into Chelsea Girls right now for WFMU listeners. Thank you again, John Waters and Mink Stole.
Thank
live
you.
From Camp John Waters.
Thanks. Nico. Oh, I met Nico.
Room 546, it's enough to make you sick. Bridget's all wrapped up in foil. You wonder if she can uncoil. Here they come now. See them run now. They come now, Chelsea girls. Here's room 115, filled with S&M queens. Magic Margaro, you wonder just how high they go. Come now, see them run now. Here they come now, Chelsea girls. Here's Pope Dear on Dean. Ron has treated him so mean. She wants another scene. She wants to be a human being. Here they come now. See them run now. Here they come now. Chelsea. She's having fun. She thinks she's some man's son. Her perfect loves don't last. Her future died in someone's past. Here they come now. See them run. They come now, Chelsea problems. tight. She can't an utter light. She wrote Susan in a ball, and now she can't see her at all. Here they come now. See them run now. Here they come now. Chelsea girls. Drop out, she's in a fix. Amphetamine has made her sick. White powder in the air, she's got no bones. And can be scared. Here they come now. See them run now. Here they come now. Chelsea girls. Johnny Barr, he collapsed on the floor. They shut him up with milk, and when he died, soaked for silk. Here they come now. See them run now. Here they come now, Chelsea girls. Here they come now, see them run now. Here they come now, Chelsea
girl. At the end of a rainbow, you'll find a pot of gold. At the end of a story, you'll find it's all been told. But our love has a treasure our hearts can always spend, and it has a story without any end. End of a river, the water stops its flow. At the end of a highway, there's no place you can go. But just tell me you love me, and you are only mine, and our love will go on till the end. The water stops its flow. At the end of a highway, there's no place you can go. But just tell me you love me, and you are only mine, and our love will go on till the end of time. Time.
know I'm following you. Whatever you climb or tumble into, why all of the time I'm following you. The battle won't be half so hard if you've someone to share it. I'll gladly carry half the load, and what's more, grin and bear it. You're part of my heart, you know that it's true. Whenever you start, I'm following you.
Did that just happen? Did John Waters and Mink Stole just come hang out for a little bit? I feel like it was a dream. Thanks for tuning in live from John Waters camp. It actually happened. I've been so nervous about this. I thought I was going to throw up, but it happened. And we're all here and we existed and we're alive. And I want to thank everybody that made this possible, including David Mumbuck and his beautiful wife, who I keep saying just beautiful wife, but your name is Kelsey. And I want to thank you both for making the sounds go out to Sam the Ram, who is board hopping from WFMU HQ. Scott Williams, thanks for making all this happen. Ken, for letting me do it. It's like the Oscars. Topher at Camp John Waters, Topher and David, thank you for all of your hospitality. Up next, we're going to have Rich Hazelton, as per usual, with his inflatable squirrel carcass. And I'm really sad that that's the last time I'm going to say that for a while. It's Mona Till Midnight, signing off for my last late night shift. And then I'm moving to 3 to 6 p.m. And haters going to hate, but it's going to be awesome. You're going to love it. you just heard Jimmy No One, I'm Following You. Earl Grant did The End from A Dirty Shame. And John Waters, it was mentioned Andy Warhol. And I remember thinking about how he was influenced by the triptych aspect of Chelsea Girls for his film, for his early films. So thankfully had that pulled. So we played Nico, Chelsea Girls, and that's it. I think I'm going to be signing off now. I'm going to play a couple more tunes until Rich Hazelton takes over. Thank you so much for tuning in. It's been my pleasure. And bye-bye now. You're listening to WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, New York City, Rockland County, 91.9 FM, online, WFMU.org. Let's talk about that obscure record he was mentioning, the Flying Saucer Rock and Roll, here on your
life to you. To you. Shaboom, if shaboom. I can take you up in paradise you, above. You. Shaboom, if shaboom. You will tell me I'm the only one you, who you love. Shaboom, to shaboom. Shaboom, sweetheart. Hello, hello again. Shaboom, I'm hoping we'll meet again. Shaboom, life could be a dream. Shaboom, if only all my precious.